appearing on our television screens for the best part of half a century. He has been with us as we move from black and white to colour. He's reported on conflicts abroad.
The war in the Lebanon has broken out again with a vengeance.
And at home.
What's it like when you try and play outside?
There's usually shooting down the streets.
He's seen us through 8 prime ministers.
Good morning, Mrs. Thatcher.
Good morning.
And 5 recessions. And throughout it all, John has been a reassuring presence.
Hello again.
Making sense of the world, from Newsround to Countryfile.
Repercussions to this.
It's a well-known phrase that you should never work with children and animals. And I've spent the last 40 years doing just that.
This is the story of the man who brought the news to children.
His role in those early news rounds was that of elder brother.
You did feel that it was especially for you.
And brightened up our Saturday mornings.
We all genuinely liked each other and we very much loved John.
He is one of the most decent, entertaining, kind, compassionate people that you could ever wish to meet.
Generations of us have grown up with John Craven, and John has grown up with us. This is a journey through the John Craven years. It's a cold morning in November, and John Craven is on location in Southport with the Countryfile team. And all I gotta do is act
naturally. 2 miles beneath the surface here, there's natural gas trapped in rocks, and getting it out involves a new technique in this country called fracking, which has...
I'm proud of being a journalist. I think it's a wonderful job. I mean, it's a great window on the world. You get this opportunity to kind of walk down a street, and in some doors you throw a bouquet and in other doors you throw a ton of bricks. But all the time you are hopefully, responsibly reporting to your audience about what is really happening.
I'll be investigating. And also on Countryfile tonight.
Journalism and broadcasting have been in John's blood ever since he was old enough to read and write.
When I was 11 or 12, I asked my parents, as a birthday present, for a microphone. And it was like one of those, you know, sports commentators hold. And it was plugged into the radio in the sitting room, and I sat in the kitchen with the Yorkshire Evening Post and read them the stories from the front page of the papers, just like a radio newsreader. And they were very tolerant. They just sat and listened.
The budding broadcaster was born in Leeds in 1940. He grew up in a country ravaged by the effects of the Second World War, and like many children, the harsh reality of conflict was brought home to him in a very personal way.
My father was captured by the Japanese in 1942 in Singapore, and he was one of the few who did survive the Death Railway. My mother didn't know whether he was dead or alive for nearly 3 years. One of my first memories was going to Leeds Station and meeting this stranger who weighed about 5 stone because, you know, the treatment he'd had in the hands of the Japanese. And he carried me on his shoulders, and I thought he was a great hero returning home from killing tigers and things like that.
Well, Mr. Nomad, you can't say I didn't pick a grand day for your trip to Bird Island.
For young boys with vivid imaginations, post-war childhood regained a sense of adventure and excitement through the radio.
For me, it was children's hour, 5 o'clock, every night, with Uncle Mac and people like that, and Norman and Henry Bones, the boy detectives, and Wandering with Nomad.
I love the little puffin. I think he has the most comical face of any bird I know.
This was a naturalist nomad who took a group of children out and on the radio explained what they were seeing, you know, as they walked down country lanes. And I think that's what first got me interested in wildlife and nature, because I was then a city kid, you know.
Radio might have nurtured a lifelong interest in the countryside, but it also provided the spark for a pop culture explosion that would transform the lives of children coming of age in the decade of pop art, rebels, and rock and roll.
It's
suddenly this this raucous American wave swept over us, and we were very impressed.
Never learned to read or write so well, but he could play a guitar just like a ring in a bell. Go, go!
Go, Johnny, go. We were the first teenagers. The word had never been heard of before. And everything was happening in fashion, in music especially. You know, Elvis Presley. Wow, I had Elvis Presley records, and my parents hated the fact. I mean, they almost banned the records from the house. And I had a DA haircut, a Tony Curtis haircut, you know. And I wore an Italian suit, you know, four buttons down the front and all that.
Brimming with teenage confidence, John Craven made his first ever television appearance in 1958 as a guest on a long-lost youth programme called The Sunday Break.
This is a cutting about my very first television interview on The Sunday Break. John Craven of Grimthorpe Street, Headingley, Leeds, is a braw laddie, as the Scots say. Last Sunday, this 18-year-old sales apprentice suddenly found himself in front of the television cameras. I say suddenly because he only had 4 days warning that he was to appear. But John didn't panic. He didn't even bat an eyelid. Not sure about that.
The Sunday Break offered teenagers a short-lived taste of TV stardom. But one of the show's more famous guests spotted John's potential.
On the very first programme, I talked to Sam Wanamaker, you know, who founded the Globe Theatre, father of Zoe Wanamaker. And in fact, Sam was very kind to me. You know, he took me on one side and he gave me a few tips. Obviously, you know, my first time on television, I was very nervous. And he said, I think you might be able to do this job.
During a tumultuous decade that spanned free love, moon landings and revolting students, John honed his journalistic skills on local papers like the Harrogate Advertiser. It wasn't until the late 60s that he broke into regional television, where runaway dogs were headline news.
He went straight into the acres of woods and grass which surround the airport, and he's resisted all attempts to capture him. He's eaten food that's been put down for him, but he took no notice of some greyhound bitches which were brought up here to try and lure him back with love.
In 1971, John gained national exposure on the BBC's flagship current affairs series, Nationwide, where the closure of local bus services was headline news.
We've had a lot of letters from the village, letters which say things like, "We love our little village, but we don't want to be buried alive in it." So we decided to use Kerry Mallet as the starting point of our inquiry. And feelings are running so high that when they discovered we were coming, this is the reception committee that greeted us.
This is the 9 o'clock news.
Although John quickly mastered the formal broadcasting style of the time, the news was a turn-off for a large and increasingly powerful section of the viewing public.
Good evening.
Children.
Children were absolutely bored stiff by the adult news, because of the way it was presented.
A leading Conservative shadow minister, Sir Keith Joseph, tonight came out firmly against any statutory incomes policy.
It was quite inaccessible, and often, because you didn't understand the context, when it came on, we would just go out of the room because it felt like it had nothing to do with us.
Yet the world was a volatile place in the early 70s, with violence on the streets of Northern Ireland, war in Vietnam, and Britain on the verge of industrial unrest. Coming from school, my head buzzing with rules that would bring any boy to his knees. The idea that television should guide children through this world began to gain ground with BBC bosses such as Monica Sims.
I belong to the school of thought which felt that it was a good thing for children to be stretched and to use their imaginations and to understand gradually the world around them.
5, 4, 3.
Producers in Bristol were the first to tap into the new mood with a programme called Search. And they recruited John Craven to present it.
Hello and welcome once again to Search. Well, how many boys do you know who can bake a cake?
And how many girls do you know who can mend the fuse?
Well, my research was the first current affairs programme, I think anywhere in the world, for children. And what we did, we looked at a topic every week, made a film about it, a short film. And then I had a studio full of children, maybe 30 or 40 children sometimes, who all wanted their say on that issue.
And I've got a younger brother than myself, and I usually get the household chores to do when he's sitting down watching television or something like that, and I don't think that's fair.
I think boys should stick to what they're made for, you know, playing with toy soldiers and things like that.
It was probably the first time that anybody had really taken children's opinion seriously. And we looked at issues, you know, some big news issues. We looked at relationships, you know, how do you get on with your grandparents? What do you think of the older generation? All those sort of things. You know, in a way, quite a breakthrough.
Search offered children a voice, but whether they had anything pressing to say was another matter.
I can't tell you how pleased I would be if I could be on television. And I know my parents would be pleased. And so would my budgie, who enjoys TV. And my pet fish, who also enjoys TV, certainly would.
Sorry, Louise, that your budgie and your pet fish, and indeed you, are going to be disappointed, because you didn't give us any real opinions in that letter, did you? So we've had...
In search, we were encouraging children to respond and give their own opinions.
Well, I disagree with making children do sports.
I'm not one of those people who likes sports, so I rather agree with Jane.
You should have shown a wider range of schools.
Siobhan, what did you think?
I have a distant memory of Search, and I think probably like every child viewer, particularly those with my temperament and ambitions, fantasised about giving my opinions on the issues of the day on that programme.
Search also encouraged children to express themselves through the medium of film.
Hello again. Well, today is the big day when we find out the winners of the Search film competition for 1971.
One of our innovations on Search was to have a film competition. Remember, this was long before videotape. Children sent in their films. They had to edit them themselves. And we picked the best ones.
Hey, kids, you did it all yourselves. You never change a world. So what you think about that?
And I was at a reception a few years ago now, and Trisha Goddard and Nick Park were there, and we were chatting. And Trisha said, oh, you probably don't remember this, John, but I entered the Search film competition, and I came second one year, and I got to make a film with the BBC crew. And it really got me interested in being on television. And Nick Park, you know, from Wallace and Gromit fame, Nick said, well, do you know, he said, I entered my very first plasticine modelled film animation to the Search film competition, and I got nowhere. They didn't even write back. So what a mistake we made there.
Congratulations mainly, of course, to Malcolm Dalton for winning the competition. He wins this, an 8mm battery-operated zoom-lensed camera.
John's performances on Search had caught the eye of the BBC's children's department in London, where the idea of a dedicated news bulletin for children had begun to gain ground.
I know we saw several other people, but John Craven seemed to have a rapport with children that did not involve talking down to them. Most children resent being treated like a child. We wanted somebody who could talk straight, and John could.
John had the qualities the producers were after, but they'd need access to the full resources of the mighty newsroom if their idea was to work. Edward Barnes, deputy head of the children's department, had to persuade the head of news to collaborate.
He poured out two enormous gins, topped up with a little warm flat tonic and no ice, and said, speak. So I told him what I wanted to do.
Right, stand by studio.
And he gave me the use of a news studio, the use of all news gathering facilities, and the use of correspondents, and everything you need to set up a news programme.
With the studio, reporters and a presenter in place, all the show needed now was a title.
I thought up the word Newsround because I wanted the audience at home to sort of connect with it. I thought, well, a lot of children have paper rounds, and this is an amalgam of, you know, paper round and television news. So we had Newsround. And then Edward said, yeah, but if it's a paper round, it's, you know, Joe Bloggs's paper round or Jill Brown's paper round. So this is John Craven's Newsround. So that's how it got its title.
First on BBC One, John Craven's Newsround.
John Craven's Newsround took to the air on the 4th of April, 1972. It was soon providing children with reports on everything from endangered birds of prey to Ugandan refugees.
Several thousand Asian children from Uganda are now settling down to life in this country, and the big problem is getting them back to school.
What we wanted to do was to explain to children what's happening in the world in a way that they're going to understand. Everything had to be totally understandable by a nine-year-old, which is quite a journalistic challenge.
I remember the first ever Newsround story, which was a great John Craven word. There was ospreys. Today we're going to be looking at some nesting ospreys and how people are helping the ospreys.
The programme broke with many of the conventions of news broadcasting.
I didn't sit behind a desk because I didn't want to appear to be a teacher.
Hello again.
Children had just got home from school. They were entitled to flop in front of the telly and enjoy what was on. And so I didn't want them to feel they were back in the classroom again. Over the
Olympic John's games, dress sense also added to his casual appeal.
Some of those shirts in the 70s, you know, the voile shirts with the great big collars and the kipper ties.
Hello again. Hello.
Hello again.
Hello again. Hello again. Hello again. Hello again. Bye for now.
But, you know, that's what everybody else was wearing at the time.
I think informal was right for the kids. It was saying this is a different kind of programme. Look up, listen up. You might find something interesting.
Will there or won't there be a general election next month? General elections are always held on a Thursday, and many schools are closed because they are used as polling stations.
I remember sitting down watching Newsround, fighting with my brothers at the same time, walloping each other with cushions and that kind of thing. And I always felt very safe with John. You trusted him, and above all else, I mean, you understood what the programme was saying.
John just governed that brilliantly, with that great sense of authority, but with warmth.
Here's a nice little one. Kashmir is now one of the world's major exporters of walnuts.
Thank you,
John. £2 million pounds a year. Nutty story.
John and the editorial team chose a mix of stories designed to capture the imagination of younger viewers.
We would try and entice the audience into watching us.
Hello again. On our Newsround tonight, from Britain, the children who are being turned away from school. From the Middle East, a million pilgrims flock to their holy city. And from Australia, surfers who may not be all they seem to be.
The most important news of the day around the world would be in Newsround, but it wouldn't necessarily be the lead story as it was in the grown-up news.
Police in New York have just made the biggest swoop on organised crime in their history. 677...
Striking the right balance between stories was crucial if Newsround was to have a long-term future.
...have been ordered to appear in court.
Not only might we be in serious trouble for parading the horrors of the world to innocent eyes and innocent ears, the innocent eyes and innocent ears were in grave danger of switching off or switching over.
To find out what children really thought of the new programme, John hosted a special edition of Search that would vindicate all their hopes.
And when you're watching children's programmes, do you want to be entertained or, like Newsround, be informed?
Informed. You learn more that way.
And if you were in charge of children's programmes, what kind of changes would you make, if any?
Mostly children instead of adults.
You'd want more children involved in programmes?
The adults are taking over the world.
So would you prefer Paul sitting in this seat for me?
Yes.
Oh. Divers rescue from the sea a piece of lost history.
I heard about this guy who was working in his garden, and his child came rushing out to tell him about this sunken treasure ship that had been discovered. And he said, "Where did you hear that?" And the child said, "On the news." And his dad said, "Don't be silly. The news isn't on until 6 o'clock. He said, "No, I heard it on my news."
A massive operation is going on to salvage a rare shipwreck.
And that's it. clicked with the audience.
You did feel that it was especially for you. It did sort of crystallise the news in a way that you can understand when you're 8, 9 or 10 years old.
With an audience of over 4 million regularly tuning in, Newsround's future was secure. The main challenge for the programme makers lay in taking difficult editorial decisions during unsettling times.
We wanted to make a programme which would widen children's horizons, but we also wanted to help them to understand the tragedies and disasters that were happening in the world, rather than them just be horrific or frightening.
More than 200 American Red Indians have captured a trading post in the state of South Dakota. They're holding people to ransom and shooting at police who try to get near.
We were dead straight. You know, we told it as it was, but in a way that was acceptable. I mean, you never saw blood on Newsround.
It all sounds like the old Wild West come to life again. But in fact, the Indians are members of a group called AIM, which stands for the American Indian Movement. And they want a better deal all round for modern Red Indians.
We didn't do murder stories unless there was some sort of kind of positive end to it, like the Yorkshire Ripper. You know, it was headlines all over the world, but we never mentioned it on Newsround until he was actually caught. And then that was just kind of reassurance thing.
The 11 hostages on the hijacked jumbo jet are now safely on their way home.
In a decade scarred by international terrorism, Newsround had to explain the politics of violence right on its doorstep.
I can't believe the news today.
Hello. New ways of cracking down on teenage violence in Northern Ireland have been put forward by a special government commission.
We had a large number of children watching us in Northern Ireland as we reported some of the horrors that went on there during the Troubles. So we were very much aware of that.
What's it like when you try and play outside?
There's usually shooting down the streets.
I do strongly remember having a sense that there were children of my age and younger who were living in Northern Ireland through what was, in effect, a war zone. And there's always a tendency in children's broadcasting to talk down and to sanitize and to leave out the bits that we think children won't get. And they didn't do that in Newsround.
Explaining the world's most complex and bloody conflicts to grown-ups was difficult enough for the newsroom's hardened correspondents.
Three men, either in the hotel or very close to it. And so the strategic
explaining them to children, Edward Barnes warned, would be even trickier.
When I talked to them, I'd say, remember, you're talking to highly intelligent people, but they have got no background information at all. This is all new to them, so don't assume knowledge.
These children live at the Sacred Heart Orphanage in Da Nang, once a principal American army base. Of the 300 here, 50 are orphans whose parents have died in the war.
The way in which children were caught up in war had a particular resonance for correspondents and the Newsround audience back home.
War is about people. I mean, one of the features of modern warfare is that children are so much caught up in it because they're unable to get out of the way. And if I was doing something about the Vietnam War, any of the other wars for Newsround, I would often try to relate them to the children in the countries I was in.
In Vietnam, orphans in the past were frequently taken into rich houses to become servants. To stop that, complex laws have been introduced. In one sense, they safeguard the children. They also make adopting them an almost interminable legal operation. Of the 300 children at Sacred Heart, only 17 will be with their new families by Christmas.
Writing of Newsround taught me to simplify, which was a very good lesson. to try to avoid jargon, often to let the sound run a little bit, or the music or whatever it might be. I think that writing for Newsround made me a better journalist, actually.
It always used to give me a huge kick, you know, when they'd send in their pieces and they'd say,
"This is Michael Burke for John Craven's Newsround in Yorktown, Virginia."
"This is John Humphreys for Newsround in Salisbury, Rhodesia."
"This is Martin Bell reporting for John Craven's Newsround."
Well,
yeah.
What we're missing? No page five. Come on, Lucy, you're late.
Newsround stories might have resonated with its young audience, but not everyone was pleased with the glimpse of the real world that the show offered.
Some people criticised it. I had one letter from a lady saying I was destroying the garden of childhood, and I dispute that. I like to think that what we were doing on Newsround was in that garden of childhood and putting a ladder up against the wall and letting children climb that ladder, see what was happening in the grown-up world over the top of the wall, and I was there as a adult friend, if you like, to explain to them what they were seeing in a way that they would understand. And that's always been my philosophy.
I beg your pardon.
Victims of war.
I never promised you a rose garden.
Gang of thieves.
Along with the sunshine.
Computer tapes.
There's gotta be a little rain sometimes.
John's convictions were borne out by Newsround's growing stature as a linchpin of the weekly schedule. But in the summer of 76, as Britain baked and punk rock brewed, he was about to embark on an adventure that would introduce him to a wider audience and reveal a very different side of his personality.
Well, I've been doing Newsround for about 4 years, I think, when Children's Television decided to do a Saturday morning show, a non-stop light entertainment show for 3 hours. First time it had ever been attempted. I think it was the longest programme the BBC ever transmitted, apart from sports programmes.
It's now 9:30, time on BBC One for the multicoloured Swap Shop.
Taking to the air in October 1976, Multicoloured Swap Shop offered viewers the chance to swap unwanted toys and games on air.
When you want to get rid of a stylophone and you would like to swap it for what?
A leather football.
In fact, we'll go back to that paper.
At the helm was former radio DJ Noel Edmonds.
But anyway, 9:30, Saturday morning, welcome indeed. I hope we find you fit and well and you're going to stay with us as long as possible on the Swap Shop this morning.
Hello, Keith.
Hi there, Noel.
Good morning.
How are you?
Yeah, very good. Have you had a good week?
Marvellous week, no problem.
He was ably assisted by two bubbly newcomers, Keith Chegwin and Maggie Philbin.
Incredible. Now tell me, what on earth made you decide to make shoes like this and that?
My dragon shoe.
Dragon shoe. It's quite fierce, actually.
I was a raw student from Manchester. I'd never done anything like this, ever. I didn't really know what I was doing. And I'd asked, I'd said, you know, should we have a run-through? Oh, no, we don't have run-throughs, don't worry about it. It was a very casual, but a deliberately casual approach.
As always on the Swap Shop, we've got a new swap. And a very good morning to John Craven.
Morning, now.
Hello.
In order to add a measure of experience, the producers turned to John Craven.
They asked me if I would take part because I think they wanted a bit of grit. They felt it was necessary to have a bit of seriousness, so that was my role.
A team of experts from the British Museum is to fly to Egypt to try to save the Sphinx from crumbling.
We've got a really packed programme today. Oh. A programme that's
morning.
Packed with...
Morning!
Morning.
Yeah.
Morning, John.
Morning.
Between them, the Swap Shop foursome would have to deliver a marathon of entertainment to the newly awake.
This was a programme that went on for, like, hours. It was, like, 3 hours. How can you do a programme for an entire Saturday morning? And then you started to watch and, oh, right, yeah, OK, this is how it works. There's a few cartoons here, and then there's a phone-in bit there.
Hello, Maria.
Hi, Delia. Hi. I'd like to know what age did you take an interest in cooking?
Well, I'm 38 now, and I started cooking at 22.
No.
We were dealing with very serious matters at times.
1981 is now the International Year of the Disabled.
Frivolous, humorous, anarchic.
We don't have any hard-working camera. All we've got is this mob here.
How long has he taken so far?
25 seconds.
25 seconds.
Hey, look up, chubby! Hey!
John might have been recruited to add some gravitas to proceedings, but he was soon caught up in the freewheeling energy of the show.
The borders gradually eroded between being serious all the time and having fun.
Looks like something out of Blake 7, doesn't he?
If you know John, there are two Johns. And he is brilliant as a broadcaster of serious matters.
Say something! I can't talk, I'm a dummy.
He also has a devilish sense of humour. We used to do pantomime every year. I remember once Noel and I got dressed up as ugly sisters and we had ricicles stuck to our cheeks, you know, as warts.
That is my face cream, sister dear. Perhaps you'd like to try some. A gal must always look her best to catch a fella handsome.
I had a few letters from viewers saying, was my hair real?
Could you please tell me if it's true that John Craven wears a hairpiece, as I've heard... as I've heard many rumours about it.
I had this jet black hair at the time, and some people thought I looked a bit like Mr. Spock. So we did Swap Trek.
John was a great performer. He really enjoyed performing, and of course I do think that his performances reached their height in, you know, the role of Spock.
Ah, oh, Mr. Speck, what kept you?
What seems to be the problem, Captain? Why this display of emotion?
The problem is...
We are heading out of control towards a previously unknown planet, and unless checked, the total destruction of our team is inevitable, and Grandstand will just have to start earlier.
They stuck some great big ears on me. There was a passing likeness.
Okay, I think those ears have gone to his head.
What about you, you Doris?
He's just trying to browbeat us.
It was great fun to do those things because, you know, for me, it was out of the ordinary. I didn't normally get dressed up to go on the telly.
Saturday mornings brought an extra dimension to John Craven because you were able to see the real John Craven as well as John Craven, the newsreader.
I'm just getting messages to say that we haven't got the film available for us at the moment.
I've been told to tell you we haven't got the film available at the moment.
Oh, thank you very much.
Sorry about that.
Yeah, that's all right.
I love working with Noel because you never knew what to expect.
We've got a little bit of a reputation for springing things on other people and for running a studio where anything can happen.
He took all sorts of chances. He was great fun to work with. I learned quite a lot about live television and the informal side of live television from Mr. Edmonds.
For some, the show's spontaneity was too much.
Certain parts of the BBC were not very pleased about this. The idea of going off into unlit areas and things like that was an anathema. And I remember getting a memo from somebody saying, the BBC, we have a reputation throughout the world of providing the finest pictures of the finest thing, and you're just chucking that out without a single thought about it. And that's really what made the programme.
On a programme where technical hitches were an occupational hazard, even veteran newsman John had to be ready to improvise with anything that came to hand.
And at the moment, a gentleman upstairs is winding the machine through so we can see brown sauce. Yes.
The videotape broke down, so we had to fill for about 5 minutes or 6 minutes.
Oh, I am sorry.
And I picked up this lamb, and I popped underneath the desk and popped, you know, and brought it up.
Have a chance. I will give all the details again in a moment.
Lamb then became quite a big fixture.
Lamb, of course, is here. You can come out now.
Since the stardust fell on him, Lamb has taken his fame very seriously. Every Saturday, he plays back the programme on his video machine to check his performance.
Sometimes it was quite hard to separate John from Lamb. And you'd be saying, right, John, you know, you've got the news to do or whatever, and he would still be operating Lamb.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are going to reveal the Lamb's mentor in the sense that you haven't done it all on your own, have you? That, in fact, a very famous impresario has had a hand in the Lamb's success. And if you'd just like, I don't know which camera can get it best of all. Oh, you're over there. Have a little look what goes on down here. Come on out, John.
Oh.
Well, this is a favourite picture of mine. It's the four of us on Swap Shop. Keith and Maggie, Noel and myself, and all having a big smile. And actually, it's not fake. We were great friends and we were having a wonderful time doing that show. And I think it shows in that picture.
On this special edition of the programme. Hello, Vince. I see you.
Swap Shop came to a close in 1982, and in a fitting symbol of the show's reputation for unscripted chaos, one of the guests made short work of the only bit that was written down.
Was that anything important?
Was
that the news?
A script.
Is that it? I was going to...
Swap Shop had made Saturday morning television essential viewing, and the BBC was quick to devise a replacement. In a year that saw war in the Falklands, the launch of Channel 4, and the secret diary of Adrian Mole, John Craven returned to action on the Saturday Superstore, accompanied by DJ Mike Reed and a host of the biggest names of the day.
Hello, I'm Mike Reed. It's 9:30 on Saturday morning and time for me to open the Saturday Superstore.
I mean, what a thrill to get up on a Saturday morning and go, who's coming in? Elton's coming in later. Is he? Oh, great, you know. And a choir. Yeah. And the England cricket captain, Mike Gatting's probably, oh, fantastic. What a bit, great. I mean, so it was terrific fun. You'd have, you know, poets, painters, astronauts, politicians. And of course, like Swap Shop before us, we were accessible to kids. You know, call in, we'll put you on air. Oh, that's great.
Hello, it's Cole.
Yeah.
Do you get on well with your children?
Yeah, I do, actually. I'm very lucky.
The live phone-in was a risky prospect for Superstore's guests in an era when children could be candid in their views.
Quick answers we've ever had.
It was decided to have the political leaders on the show, and they all agreed. First, we had David Steele from the Liberals.
Hello, Christian. Good morning. You're through to David Steele.
Hello, Christian.
Do you ever get fed up with the spitting image puppets poking fun at you?
Yes, sometimes, but you've got to be able to laugh at yourself in politics.
And then the next week, we had Neil Kinnock from Labour, and then on the third week, along came the Prime Minister, Margaret Thatcher.
We do have the Prime Minister with us in the store this morning, Mrs. Thatcher, making her first visit to Saturday Superstore. You can ring her and talk to her, ask her anything you like. The phones are open now.
You can't imagine many other shows having that kind of, appeal.
Well, we welcome into Superstore our special guest this morning, one of the world's most powerful women, the Prime Minister, Mrs. Thatcher. Good morning, Mrs. Thatcher.
Good morning.
Thank you for joining us this morning. What would you be doing?
Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher's appearance led to one of the most awkward encounters of her career.
You're nervous. I'm nervous. That's good. That gives me a lot more confidence.
Yes, I'm nervous as well.
Some of the questions really surprised her. In particular, there was one from a young girl.
Hello.
Hello, Alison.
Hello. In the event of a nuclear war, where will you be?
Oh, my goodness me.
Gasps from everybody. And Margaret Thatcher said, well, the whole point of our policies over the last 30 years or so is this will not happen.
The whole point of those weapons is to say, well, any war would be so horrific that it doesn't start. And that's been right. It hasn't. So that's the purpose of it, dear.
But if there is one, where will you be?
I should be in London.
So this little child was persistent. She said, you know, if it did, where would you, have you got a bunker under number 10 or something?
Don't you have your own bunker or something?
Look, dear, let me again point out, the possession of these weapons has kept the peace for 40 years.
Questions you couldn't ask. It would be naive of you to do that. Do you have your own bunker? Nailed us to the wall.
It's like the bully in the playground. They don't attack strong guys. They try to attack the weak ones.
Well, thank you, Alison. Let's move on now to the next call.
Well, and it was left to the Sunday papers to reveal that, you know, there is indeed a bunker under number 10.
After a bruising encounter with a persistent caller, the Prime Minister then had to face an even more daunting task, judging the week's pop videos.
There we are, the girls used to sing with Wham, that's Pepsi and Shirley, and Heartache.
Good voices, professional production, but not quite what I would expect of Heartache. I would say 3.
She was honest. I mean, she could easily have mugged up. She could easily have got her people to say, we want to know what the videos are. She could have sat down at home and watched them and thought, right, made some notes and what have you. But she didn't. She was unerringly honest and said, look, I won't pretend to be a big pop fan. I won't pretend to know anything about them, but I'll just judge on what I hear.
Kelly, thank you very much.
Thank you, Kelly.
That's all we have time for, right. Prime Minister.
Equally at ease with heads of state and stubborn children, John Craven's appearances on Saturday morning brought a new audience to Newsround.
Help at last for the victims of Africa's man-made famine.
Newsround figures went up as a result of John becoming more of a friendly figure than a newsreader, really. It worked tremendously well for us.
Newsround's reputation had grown with its audience, with the programme often breaking stories that would once have been exclusive to the newsroom.
Shocked reaction to the news that Pope John Paul II has been shot. A gunman shot at the Pope in his Popemobile just before he was about to make his appearance at a regular audience in St. Peter's Square, Rome.
Newsround, for a long time, was the first news bulletin of the day on television. There were no breakfast newses or no lunchtime newses, no 24-hour news stations. It meant that we got quite a few big scoops.
In a decade when nations woke up to the plight of the Third World, from famine in Africa to poverty in India, Newsround dispatched John in person to report back on global issues and meet iconic figures for the Newsround Extra strand.
For being a good boy and sitting in the studio for 9 months or 10 months of the year, they let me out and I went to some fascinating places. I went to the Taj Mahal and explained the effect of pollution and the way it was eating away at the marble there. I went looking for tigers and all sorts of things.
Hello again. Today, Newsround Extra is in India, and I'm on my way to the city of Calcutta to meet an extraordinary lady, a woman who's famous throughout the world, but who herself is as poor as the people that she cares for, Mother Teresa.
In the 1980s, an Albanian nun called Mother Teresa had become renowned throughout the world for her work with the poor and the needy.
I knocked on the door, and I couldn't believe it. Mother Teresa opened the door. One of the most famous ladies in the world.
And did you ever imagine when you began your work here that you would become so famous?
Nothing at all. Talking about me, naturally they speak about the poor. In helping me, naturally they're helping them.
It was early morning, and Mother and the 300 nuns who live here had just finished Mass and were preparing for the day ahead.
Then she said to me, "We have a habit, a spare habit, and a bucket to wash them in. These are our only possessions." And I said to her, "Well, what about the Order of Merit? Because the Queen gave you the Order of Merit, which is one of the highest awards she can give." I said, "And I've never seen you with it." She said, "Well, let me take you to my private chapel." And there was a statue of the Madonna with the Order of Merit round the neck, and she said it was for her.
God bless you.
Thank you, Mother.
Mother Teresa might have welcomed John in person, but in South Africa, where inequality was a product of government policy, one door slammed firmly shut.
I went there to do some filming and got to the airport in Johannesburg, and this official looked through the big book and he said, "I'm sorry, Mr. Craven, but you're banned in this country." So I wasn't allowed in. And I went on to Rhodesia, Zimbabwe, instead. And it was only later that I discovered that the reason I was banned was that the South African government, who had tapes of all BBC bulletins sent down to them in Pretoria, they didn't like the way that Newsround always, whenever we mentioned apartheid, we qualified it to explain what it meant.
Apartheid, the separation of black and white people in South Africa. The South African cricket team is strictly whites only, in line with the apartheid laws. This local club for white South Africans is next door to one for the blacks, but there the conditions are very different.
They didn't like that constant repetition of the fact, so that's why I was banned, you know. So, very proud of that.
After 15 years in the Newsround hot seat, John also became the programme's editor in 1987, a year that saw the Great Storm and the Hungerford Massacre. Conscious of the programme's responsibility to explain the most sensitive topics to its young audience, Newsround then tackled the AIDS crisis.
Well, now for that special report that I told you about last night. Scientists in many countries are searching for a cure for a deadly disease called AIDS, which is very much in the news at the moment.
We thought it was important to cover the AIDS thing because we've been told that children were getting all kinds of wrong ideas about AIDS. They thought they might get it from toilet seats. They thought they might get it if their daddy gave them a kiss. Stupid things like that, which, you know, playground gossip, which goes out of all proportion. So I thought it was important that we set the record straight. And we did it without ever mentioning sex, which is quite an achievement.
Its main victims are some older people, and because of all the attention that's been given to AIDS, they should now be very much aware of the risks.
John's report would prove controversial for an unexpected reason.
In those days, Philip Schofield was doing the presentation on children's television with his little puppet, Gordon the Gopher. And I had a word with Phil and I said, because Newsround is quite serious today, maybe best not to lark about too much with Gordon before and after it. He said, fine, yeah, we'll banish Gordon for those two slots. And indeed he did. And I checked the log the next morning, the audience log, to see what, you know, whether there had been any complaints about our tackling AIDS. There had been a couple. But there were far more complaints about Gordon the Gopher not appearing with Philip, which put things into perspective.
Gordon is cool, they say. Gordon is cool. Look at that, though. I mean, you are this morning.
Let's Gophers aside, there is one furry creature with a special place in the hearts of the Newsround audience.
The giant panda, giant pandas, giant panda, giant panda, an urgent plan to save China's giant pandas.
The number of stories we ran about pandas, unbelievable.
£1 million is needed to help bring pandas together and to keep people away. Roger Finn explains.
There was a huge vogue for pandas. Pandas became almost a symbol of countries getting together. Also, they're just incredibly cute. There's no such thing as a dull panda picture.
In fact, we did an April Fool once.
And finally tonight at London Zoo, attention has been growing over the large black and white egg that's been sitting in the panda cage.
The solitary egg, with its distinctive markings, lay still among its small nest of straw, a mystery to the visitors who daily peer into the panda cage. But for Cha Cha, used to the glare of the cameras, it was just another day at the zoo, munching thoughtfully on his diet of bamboo shoots.
April Fool's pranks are a part of a Newsround tradition of ending on a lighter story, generally preceded with John Craven's trademark sign-off, and finally.
And finally today, the tale of the runaway cow that's been causing quite a commotion.
I didn't want the audience to go to sleep having nightmares, you know? So we'd always end up with something amusing.
And finally tonight, a student from Bristol has slithered into the record books by sitting in a bath of spaghetti for 73 hours. And finally tonight, there's been strange happenings on the Cheltenham racecourse this morning, where Operation Newt went into action.
And finally, might be a Craven catchphrase, but its origin has been hotly debated.
There's always been a dispute between Newsround and News at 10 over who was the first to say, and finally. And I believe that Newsround was the first, no disputing.
The phrase even inspired a sketch on satirical puppet show, Spitting Image.
Mr. Craven, sir, we're in a bit of a jam on the grown-up news because we haven't got a funny story to put at the end.
Well, you jolly well can't have mine.
Oh, surely I can have the one about Frank the tortoise who had some babies?
Ah, that's my lead story. It's a world scoop.
Oh, well, all right.
In a year that witnessed the fall of the Berlin Wall and the end of the Cold War, John Craven delivered his very last and finally on the 22nd of June, 1989.
And finally, this is the last time I'll be saying, and finally. And there's no funny story today because for me, this is a rather sad moment. I've come to the end of my very last Newsround. I've had a great time over the last 17 years bringing you the news at 5 o'clock, and I'd like to thank everybody behind the scenes who's helped me do it.
It was a very emotional day when I said goodbye to the Newsround audience. It had been so much part of my life for such a long time, and I've been so proud of it. You know, a television first, a programme that everybody respected, really. The fiercest critics of television always have nice things to say about Newsround.
Newsround will be back again on Monday, but from me, bye-bye.
Just 3 days after leaving Newsround, John joined the BBC's fledgling rural affairs series, Countryfile. His very first report looked at the trend towards organic farming.
But now, more and more, the consumers are wanting food that's grown in this kind of soil that hasn't seen a drop of chemical of any kind for many, many years.
Well, when I moved to Countryfile, my life couldn't have been more different, really. After all those years of doing live television, I was working on a recorded programme, and instead of being in a studio in London, I was in the middle of fields, with the wind blowing your words away and the frost sealing your lips and still trying to look happy.
Since joining Countryfile in 1989, John has reported on everything from the foot and mouth crisis to the countryside march.
It's not just the fox hunting, it's the whole countryside, the whole country way of life.
In the process, he's won over a notoriously reticent audience.
Farmers have always been reluctant to talk to people like me about their business and the way they feel about things. Many of them won't even tell their neighbours about that, you know. So Countryfile, they realised eventually it was a very good platform for them to put over their point of view. 93, 4, 94,
94 and again, 5. I think John Craven has built up a huge amount of respect from farmers and landowners. When there were some difficult times in farming, there was BSC, there was salmonella scares, there were some animal welfare issues. John went out and reported on them, like a good journalist should do.
So just exactly what...
He knows what he's talking about. He cares about what he's talking about. And most of all, you know, he cares about the viewer. He cares about the people that are watching.
To protect the countryside from this.
With Countryfile regularly commanding audiences of 6 million viewers, John's status as a household name is assured.
It says that when supermarkets set up shop, that needn't mean disaster for local traders.
But with it comes the dubious honour of being impersonated.
Good morning and welcome to Countryfile with me, John Craven. Think of me as a sort of decaffeinated Nick Ross.
Well, one thing I've had to get used to recently is John Culshaw taking me off on the Impression Show. Which came as a bit of a shock at first.
Hello again, and welcome to Countryfile with me, John Craven. Yes, if they'd still let me wear a sweater, I would go back to Newsround.
You don't realise that you have these kind of affectations, you know, that Mr. Culshaw has picked up on.
You see the red jacket there, and the hands in the pockets, and the way that he would sort of punctuate, the way that he would speak through the story or the item with a certain amount of going to one side like that and then over to the other side, and there was this sort of visual rhythm that accompanied the vocal style, like that, which was a great thing to play with. This week I'm in Hertfordshire to look at what remains of our wonderful British Greenbelt before it disappears completely.
The biggest surprise of all, though, was on the 20th anniversary programme of Countryfile, and I was just sitting, working on my next bit of script, and suddenly behind me, I heard my voice.
Hello again, and on this special 20th anniversary of Countryfile, what better way to surprise John Craven than with another John Craven?
John, how are you?
John Craven went Adam to find out more.
Hello, John. Well, how about that?
It is a moment that I do enjoy, that moment when you meet someone you do an impression of for the first time. You never quite know how it's going to go. It's always a little bit tentative.
Happy birthday!
Well, thank you very much. It's all the jacket.
Now, welcome to Countryfile. Newsround was 20-odd years ago. This is what I do now. Get over it. And you're looking for a little flicker of reaction, as if to say, was it all right? Did we overstep the mark?
Well, I'm very impressed with the impression, actually.
Oh, thank you.
I wasn't quite sure about being on Brokeback Mountain, but...
No, with Bill Oddie.
That's what I call the funky gibbon.
Damn right.
So far, he's been quite kind to me. But I live in trepidation.
I think it'd be rather cool to do a sketch with John, with John as he is now on one side, and I'd like to play his character as it was from the 1970s, with the dark hair and with the jumpers, with the knitwear, and just see how they'd get on. See how these two eras of John Craven would interact with each other in a sort of a Life on Mars kind of way. That might be fun. That might be fun if you do that.
In the 5 decades since John Craven first appeared on our screens, the world has changed. Wars have been won and lost. Politicians have come and gone. Fortunes have been made and squandered. Yet some things remain constant.
Well, from my point of view, my job has hardly changed since I was a junior reporter on the Harrogate Advertiser. It's still reporting the truth, getting the facts right, and then reporting them in a way that people are going to find entertaining and informative and balanced.
Those journalistic values underpinned the success of a programme that is still going strong after 40 years.
Ladies and gentlemen, the BAFTA Special Award goes, of course, to Newsround.
You know, a lot of people in our business tend to be remembered for programmes which they personally would prefer to forget. But I'm terribly proud of Newsround, always have been. And it does come as a bit of a shock, though, these days, when people who I think look pretty old come up to me and say, thank you for being part of my childhood.
Generations of us have grown up with John Craven, and those who have been lucky enough to work with him have cherished the experience.
We all genuinely liked each other, and we very much loved John. I think you can smell it through the screen, and that made, I think, the audience all the fonder of John.
And it's all about the Red Devil.
We can even forgive him the occasional fashion faux pas.
Yeah, I mean, he did have some amazing pullovers, which I hope he's now sold or given to Oxfam, but then again, I have to confess, we all did.
I'm going to swap one of my jumpers. I'll swap this one, I think, because people were always asking about my jumpers.
If you go and say John Craven's name to people, they'll smile and they will always say something appreciative. And that is the mark of somebody who's made an area of broadcasting their own.
Somewhere in a distant corner of Britain, John Craven is still doing what he does best.
I've been on television a long time now, almost every week, I suppose, for the last 40 years. It's such a great job, actually, because you never know what's going to happen next week. And that keeps me going, I think.
That desire to make sense of the world and share it with others has driven John ever since he was old enough to hold a microphone.
If I come away thinking I've learnt something, well, maybe the audience have as well. And, yeah. Dean, what do you want?
Sorry to break it up. Yeah. Still got a bit of work to do.
Oh, really? Yeah, and it's rapidly camera, getting dark.
We've got the last vestiges, yeah. That there's sunlight.
Oh, look at that. Sunset. Ah.
I think maybe if we did it.
I hate the thought of retiring. I mean, I'll keep on going as long as people want me to. I'll probably be retired rather than volunteer to retire. I just want to keep on going.